pancreas is an exocrine and endocrine gland which has both the function. It secretes some enzymes which helps in digestion of the protein and fats within the intestine. All these enzymes are released from pancreatic acinar glands. They join together to form ductules and then the main pancreatic ducts. This main pancreatic duct carries this pancreatic juice, and at the ampulla it mixes with the bile to be secreted into the intestine, where it helps in digestion. Pancreas also secretes two important hormones, insulin and glucagon, which is responsible for controlling the sugar. Why pancreatitis occurs is there are different causes of pancreatitis, like most commonly gallstone disease and alcohol intake that contributes to 70 to 80% cases of pancreatitis. Gallstone is more common in females, and alcohol particularly associated with binge drinking. The real mechanism how alcohol causes is unclear. Other than alcohol and gallstones, pancreatitis is also caused after ERCP, post-ERCP in 5 to 10% of cases. May be due to some anatomical causes, may be due to hypertriglyceridemia, in which there is a familial condition of increased level of triglycerides in the blood. It may be due to some anatomical disorders or hereditary conditions. The basic mechanism how pancreatitis happens is either there is a duct obstruction theory in which pancreatic duct is blocked, and there is stimulation of the pancreatic enzymes within the pancreatic gland that leads to autogyrization of the pancreatic tissue. That is called acinar cell theory. Sometimes there may be some genetic link associated with the stimulation of the pancreatic enzymes within the pancreas gland. Patients with pancreatitis, usually they present with upper abdominal pain just below the ribs. It is very severe pain, and this usually radiates to the back. This pain usually follows a binge drinking, and it is so severe that you need to take some analgesic injections. There may be associated vomiting also. You may have fever, and there is, on examination, what we found is whole abdomen is swollen, it is tender, and associated there may be, you may be have a low blood pressure, maybe high temperature, your urine output would have come down. So it's a very serious conditions. And what happens once the doctor suspects you to have a pancreatitis? They usually advise you to undergo certain blood tests like serum amylase and serum lipase. These two tests are usually raised in majority of the cases of pancreatitis. These are very common tests. The labels more than 300-500, we most likely suspect to have pancreatitis. Other than that, your doctor may also advise you to undergo X-ray of the abdomen to exclude other conditions like perforation of the hollow viscus or intestinal obstruction. But to confirm the diagnosis, we initially go for an ultrasound abdomen pelvis. But detailed anatomical knowledge of the pancreatitis is well understood with a CT scan of abdomen and pelvis. Other than this initial test as a CT scan, sometimes after 5 to 7 days of treatment also, you may need to have undergo repeated CT scans to know the status or the benefits of the treatment compared to previous CT scan done 7 to 10 days back. So basically, after all these investigation reports come, we classify these patients to be either mild pancreatitis, moderate pancreatitis, or severe pancreatitis. Mild means you don't have any local complications and you don't have any organic or systemic complications. In moderate pancreatitis, you have organ system damage and you may have also some local complications, but these are short lasting and it stays for less than 48 hours or for 2 days time. However, in severe pancreatitis, you have a definite organ damage and multiple local complications which stays for more than 48 hours. So in severe pancreatitis, you need to be treated in the ICU, while in mild pancreatitis, you can be managed in the ward with monitoring of your vitals. So during treatment, initially you will undergo nasogastric aspiration. They put a Ryle's tube through the nose to decompress the stomach. Lot of IV fluids are given to combat the dehydration associated with pancreatitis. Antibiotics are administered to control the infection, and pain management is most important in pancreatitis. You may require opioid analgesics, like fortuin or pentazocin, and particularly in severe pancreatitis, you need to be regularly checked up for damage of different organ systems like respiratory system. Your saturation needs to be monitored, repeat chest x-ray needs to be done, spirometry started, nebulizations are given. For renal status, 1 hourly urine output chart is mentioned, regularly urea creatinine samples are mentioned. So despite all this treatment, in 20-30% cases, the mortality is very high in severe pancreatitis. You may die in severe pancreatitis. While majority of the patient or 100% of patients in mild pancreatitis, they improve with this medical management. Surgery is required in 5-10% of the patients. There are two important conditions within acute pancreatitis in which surgery may be required. One is a infected pancreatic necrosis or a peripancreatic fluid collection which has got infected, and patient fails to medical management despite maximum ICU care. So here what happens, there is infected and purulent material are collected around the pancreas, and that does not subside, causes sepsis or septicemia. So we do surgery to remove all those infected material. So either this can be drained by radiologically by putting a ultrasound or CT guided, a drain can be placed, or you can do a endoscopic drainage in which you can do a transmural drainage, US endoscopic ultrasound guided drainage of the peripancreatic collection. And sometimes it is large enough collection and no proper approach is available to drain it endoscopically, then surgery is done. In surgery, either we can do it endoscopically or laparoscopically. Similarly, a condition called pseudocysto pancreas, in which there is a well-defined collection with a definite wall, that usually occurs in 20-30% of pancreatitis patients. Majority of these patients who developed pseudocyst also resolve spontaneously. So we recommend that these patients should wait for 4-6 weeks time, and serial follow-up should be done with the CT scan. Those patients in which there is a persistent abdominal swelling and difficulty in eating and your sepsis is persistent, in such scenario we need to drain the pseudocyst. This drainage can again be done either radiologically or endoscopically, or surgically, either you can drain it into the stomach, that is called cystogastrostomy, or you can do into the intestine, that is called cystogastrostomy. So majority of these patients, they improve with this medical management with a 10-20% of mortality for very severe cases. What happens after this pancreatitis attack is settled? Majority of these patients, unlike chronic pancreatitis, does not develop any problem for the future after improvement from the pancreatitis. Certain restriction needs to be done. Those patients who have pancreatitis due to heavy alcohol intake are suggested not to take alcohol for rest of their life. It should be absolutely banned, and smoking should be stopped, and spicy food or heavy meals should be avoided in such patients to prevent any future attack of pancreatitis. Patients who have gallstone pancreatitis should either undergo laparoscopic cholecystectomy, so remove the stones. So what used to say, that there will be no stones, no pancreatitis. So those are for gallstone pancreatitis. In mild cases, in the same hospitalization, laparoscopic cholecystectomy can be done. But with moderate to severe gallstone pancreatitis, we recommend a period of 3-4 weeks gap before removal of the gallbladder. Thank you.